If you're a guest, I'm sorry. Hey, welcome. Glad you're here. Thanks for coming out to Twickenham, where we enjoy one another a lot.
Too much.
And we're not perfect, okay? So mistakes will be made today. So if you'll...
That was their mistake, not mine.
And blame will be shifted, so... But we obviously get along, okay? So, hey, if you're a guest, really, thanks for coming out to be with us. And if you're a regular member, we're glad you're here. Hey, Balcony, how you doing? Everybody good? There we go. There you go. Sit down. Hey, we want to welcome a new family. Despite everything you just saw, people still want to be a part of this church. So Wes and Christine Alexander and their kids Molly and Calvin, are you guys here? Can y'all stand? Hey, welcome. Glad you guys are here. Give them a hand. Look them up later on and just to get to know them a little bit. No, seriously, thanks for coming out. There's a card on the seat in front of you. You can fill that out if you're a guest this morning, and we'll send you some information about our church. If you have a prayer request, put it on the card. We'll be praying over that in the morning. First thing, actually, we'll be praying over those this afternoon. So go ahead and fill those out. And again, God bless you for being here. We're kind of focusing on coming into the presence of God this morning. And here's the weird thing about that. God is everywhere. God is already here. And our task is to enter into that presence, into the awareness of God. And that's where our worship is going to lead us this morning. So how about we stand together and let's praise the Lord together in song and literally stand this time. It's all good. So
give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. He is good, He is above all things, His love endures forever. Sing praise, with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, His love endures forever. And for the life that's been reborn, His love endures forever.
Forever God is faithful, forever. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make a bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there, your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. Would you be seated as we take our offering and consider his presence some more?
In his presence,
just a couple of days ago, a group of our fellow Twickenhammers returned from about a week and a half long trip to Israel, and I've enjoyed hearing some of the stories. My parents were among those that went, got plenty of text message pictures sent back, and honestly, it's a trip that I'd like to take one day, but the stories that they've told about being in the places where Jesus walked, stories that we've all heard pretty much our whole lives. Taking a boat ride on the Sea of Galilee, where Jesus calmed the water, Jesus walked on the water, on the shores of which he fed the masses, the Mount of Olives, where he preached the Sermon on the Mount, the Jordan River, where he was baptized. And these events truthfully, aside from the miraculous events that occurred, are a little bit easier for me to place myself in. You know, I can imagine myself being in that physical location, certainly seeing the pictures of the actual places where they occurred. It's a little bit easier for me to put myself as opposed to what we're talking about this morning. So today's lesson in the God Is series is God is everywhere. We just sang about the peace and the comfort of being in the presence of God. But for me, thinking about the omnipresence of God can take me to a very different place, almost a frightening place. I can't help but think of some of the other Bible stories and scriptures that, quite frankly, don't give me quite such a warm and fuzzy feeling. Adam and Eve, realizing their sin, tried to hide from God in the garden. Obviously, they could not hide. Jonah didn't want to go preach to the people of Nineveh, so he tried to flee. He could not. We just read Psalm 139. David said, "Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence?" And to be honest, these passages really just stand to remind me that in the times of my biggest mistakes, my greatest sins, my most epic failures, that God was right there in every one of them. But thankfully, he didn't turn his back on me there. He didn't leave us there. Instead, he sent Jesus. And Jesus came and walked those same streets in Israel, but he made no big mistakes, horrible sins, or epic failures, despite all of the same temptations that we face. Jesus came to earth to become relatable to us, to be present with us, and to stand in our place when we're called to account for our actions. Hebrews chapter 4 tells us, "Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need." God's ability to be everywhere at once can be scary. But Paul tells us in his letter to Timothy that God did not give us a spirit of fear. Through Jesus, God has created a way for us to come near without fear. Like us, Jesus experienced all the limitations of space and time. He knows what it is to be scared, to be tired, to be hungry. Because he became relatable to us, he's able to empathize with our weaknesses and our failures. And because of that, we can stand confidently and without fear before God. Let's pray. God, we are so thankful that you are everywhere. We're thankful for your strength and our weakness, for your mercy and for your grace. And we're thankful for this reminder that we're about to take of Jesus, for his time on earth, his sacrifice and his broken body, and ultimately his resurrection. Amen.
Thank you.
As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people. As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people.
God, we're thankful for this juice that we're about to partake and for the symbol of what it represents to us, for the blood that was spilled by your Son to cover our sins so that we can stand confidently before you. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people. As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people.
couple of weeks ago, I think everybody knows about this now, Shelby and Jesse Coring, our youth minister family, informed us that they are going to relocate closer to family, and we regret that they are leaving us. But we bless them. It's a good thing to move closer to family, and so we will be sending them off with blessings in a few weeks. But obviously, we are going to be looking to replace that position, and so we are right now in prayer about that, and I hope you are joining us in prayer about that. Next Sunday morning, during the Sunday school hour, we'll be meeting with parents that have kids in our youth group or will have kids in our youth group down in the Mercy Building, 9 o'clock in the Mercy Building. If you're a parent with kids that are in the youth group or are going to be in the youth group very soon, we just kind of like to hear from you, get some input on what you think our strengths in our youth ministry are, maybe what are some of our growing edges, and kind of your heart on what we're looking for in a youth ministry. And then the Sunday after that, we'll be having a conversation with you guys about that thing during the Sunday school hour. So keep that kind of put that on your calendar and join us if you're a parent next Sunday in the Mercy Building, and then Sunday after that, we'll be down in your guys' area. Glasses, here we go. Never know if they're in a pocket or on my head. So there is absolutely no excuse any longer for getting lost. Our planet is orbited by hundreds, maybe thousands of satellites. Some of them we know about. Some of you know about. The rest of us don't. But they are constantly mapping and remapping our planet and the roadways that we travel. In-dash global positioning devices are almost standard now on all vehicles. And even if you don't have a car that has that, you've got your phone and you've got coordinates there. And even if you don't have that, you can still get that old technology that you stick on your windshield that tells you where you are and where you want to go. And all of these devices and technologies are precise down to the last yard, foot, and inch, or kilometer, meter, and centimeter. You can type your address into Google Earth and see your house or your neighbor's house or your neighbor sitting in his backyard with his laptop looking at you, looking at him. It's almost that way. There's just no, if you get lost, that's on you. There's no excuse for it anymore. There's also no excuse any longer for being out of touch or unavailable. When you hear a voice message that says, "I'm sorry, I can't get to my phone right now," do you know what that is? That's a lie. Because the phone is in their pocket or their purse or on their ear, and all they have to do is say hello. That's all. There's just no excuse for it. And the truth is, you can sit down at your computer or with your phone, and you can talk to people face to face. There's Skype and there's FaceTime. My mother is in her 80s. She's on Instagram. When my daughter-in-law does a live Instagram feed of my mother's great-grandchild, my mother sends me a message, "He's on." There's just no excuse for not being available and connected these days. And there's absolutely no excuse for not being up on the latest current events. There's just no excuse for it, regardless of whether those events have any impact on your life or not. If a young boy gets his head stuck in a stone rail in China and the authorities have to use the jaws of life to free him, I know about that. That happened last week. I watched it live. It's like I was there. I was there when PricewaterhouseCoopers handed Warren Beatty the wrong envelope for the best picture, and he read it live at the Oscars. Were you there too? Did you know that on January 8th, Highway 401 in Ontario, Canada was closed due to a 100-car pileup because of icy roads? And I watched it. Truck after truck after truck slamming into car after car after car. I was just there. I watched the whole thing happen. There is no excuse for not being up on what's going on. It's impossible to lose yourself in unfamiliar territory. It's impossible to be out of touch. It's impossible to be uninformed. In Christianity Today, Andy Crouch wrote, "Modernity is built in no small part on technologies of presence. From the cellular phone to television to air travel, we are embedded in a web of devices that make us seem to be somewhere we are not, or that remove us from one place and take us to another at speeds that would have seemed supernatural to our ancestors." That sense of being in touch with every event in every place on our planet can give us an almost godlike feeling of ubiquity. Nothing is hidden from our view. Nowhere is beyond our ability to explore. But it takes only the slightest glitch in the grid to put us back in our place. Sometimes our technology fails us. Went to Atlanta this weekend to check on Mom and Dad. On the way there, I was on the phone with Lisa, and the call dropped. Then I was on the phone with Lisa, and the call dropped. And I was on the phone with Lisa, and the call dropped, because I was in some back Georgia roads doing this, going up and down, and I kept going into dead cell areas. Sometimes the system fails us. And then sometimes we fail our technology. A couple of years ago, a 46-year-old German motorist was driving along a busy road, and suddenly he just veered left. He jumped the curb, and he ended up stuck on a railroad track because his satellite navigation system told him to turn left, and there was nowhere to turn. And then sometimes our technology is used against us. Airliners, automobiles, cell phones, these can be magic carpets to take us to extraordinary journeys, or they can become the monstrous components of improvised explosive devices. Regardless of why it happens, technological failures remind us that we are creatures confined by both space and time. Every day, your heart beats around 104,000 times, give or take. Your blood travels 171,000 miles. You breathe 23,000 times, inhaling 438 cubic feet of air. You move 752 muscles and exercise 8 million brain cells, and you do it all in one place at one time. God, however, does not experience those space-time limitations. God is there. God is here. And here's how we're finishing the sentence today. God is everywhere, all at once. Now, concepts like that are often best captured in poetry. And we heard this just a minute ago, but I want to read a little bit more of it in a different translation, Psalm 139. Just listen to how David describes it. "O Lord, you have examined my heart and know everything about me." Terrified yet? "You know when I sit down or stand up. You know my thoughts even when I'm far away. You see me when I travel and when I rest at home. You know everything I do. You know what I'm going to say even before I say it, Lord." That means the Lord's in your hand. "You go before me and follow me. You place your hand of blessing on my head. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too great for me to understand. I can never escape from your spirit. I can never get away from your presence. If I go to heaven, you are there. If I go down to the grave, you are there. If I ride the wings of the morning, if I dwell in the farthest oceans, even there, your hand will guide me and your strength will support me. I could ask the darkness to hide me and the light around me to become night, but even in darkness, I cannot hide from you. To you, the night shines as bright as day. Darkness and light are the same to you. Jeremiah 23, God says, am I God who is only close at hand, says the Lord? Nope. I am far away at the same time. Far away at the same time. Can anyone hide from me in the secret place? Am I not everywhere in all the heavens and in all the earth, says the Lord? Now, I'll be the first one to admit to you that God's unlimited presence is difficult to understand. Back in the Old Testament, 1 Kings chapter 20, the enemies of Israel, Syria, didn't get it. They had a battle with Israel in the mountains, and they lost. And so they said, well, their gods must be the gods of the hills. That's why they were too strong for us. So let's fight them on the plains. So a year later, they had a battle with Israel on the plains, and they lost there too. I guess they forgot that David said, even though I walk through the valley, right? And then some people misconstrue this idea of God's omnipresence, which is the $10 theological word for what we're talking about here, the everywhereness of God. They misconstrue that as a form of pantheism. Pantheism is the idea that everything is God. A tree is God, a rock is God, the seat you're sitting on is God, the person sitting next to you is God, this building is God. The Bible doesn't teach that everything is God. The Bible teaches that God is everywhere, not everything. Now, and there are some passages that I guess could be a little bit confusing, that seem to suggest that God moves from one place to another. Last year, we looked at Genesis 11, I think it was this year, and we talked about Abraham, and the lead up to Abraham was the tower, the story of the Tower of Babel in Genesis chapter 11. And at one part of that story, it says that God came down. Remember that part? God came down to look at the tower. And so it sounds like God was there and then he came down over here. What that actually is a little bit of Hebrew humor, because the people of Babel were really proud of their engineering and architectural expertise, and they'd built this really tall tower, the tallest tower that had ever been built, and they were really proud of it. And so when Moses says that God came down, what he's saying is their tower wasn't really so much. God had to come down to look at it. Ha, ha, ha. It's not real funny to us, but the Hebrews just, they doubled over. The Bible tirelessly proclaims that God is everywhere all the time. And I don't know if that means that God is just really, really big, or if it means that he's remarkably fast, or if he somehow creates and navigates rips in the space-time continuum, or if he occupies some timeless dimension that's woven into our own. I have no idea how he does that. I kind of like the way Paul put it in Acts chapter 17. In him we live and move and have our being. Let's just leave it at that. But it does have some implications, this idea of God being everywhere. For one thing, if God is everywhere all the time, then you can resign your position as general manager of the universe. See, our technologies make us think that we have overcome the limitations of space and time, but they also make us think that we have a lot more control than we do. But we don't. Here's what we do. When you meet somebody new, do you realize now that it takes about 10 minutes, when you meet a new person in your life, it takes about 10 minutes to tell them all the ways they can get in touch with you? Here's my cell number. Here's my work number. Some of us still have a home phone, a landline. Then you got your personal email and your work email and your GPS coordinates, you know, and pretty soon we'll just come equipped with barcodes and we can scan each other, right? And what that really is our aspirations to universal availability And what we really are saying is, whatever's going on, you just call me and get in touch with me, and I'll be able to fix it, and I'll be able to manage it, and I'll be able to control it. But we can't. See, routinely, we disappoint other people, and other people disappoint us. And try as we may, we can't be everywhere all the time. Only God can do that. And even if we could be everywhere, there's often not anything we can do about anything. See, when I wade into the ocean, I'm not the one who makes waves. And when I step out of the ocean, you know who misses me? Nobody. The ocean certainly doesn't miss me. It didn't even notice me. God is the one who makes the waves. God is the one who is in control. If he's everywhere, you don't have to be. So let that go. The second thing, implication here is that if God is everywhere all the time, then every moment and every space is lived in his presence. From the very beginning, human beings have tried to impose the constraints that limit us on God. Adam mentioned this a little bit earlier. When Adam and Eve sinned, they tried to hide from God as if they could find a place in his garden where he wasn't. Solomon knew a lot better than that in 1 Kings chapter 8. When he dedicated the temple, he said, "Will God really dwell on earth? Behold, the heavens cannot contain you, how much less this house that I've built." I get a kick out of two regular occurrences that I notice every now and then. Parents who will, this happens less and less, but this used to happen a lot, especially when I was a kid. Parents would say to their children not to run and play in God's house. Don't run and play in God's house. And then people who apologize for swearing in front of me when they find out I'm a preacher. Both of those responses assume that God is located either literally or figuratively or symbolically in a building or in a person. And my response to the first one is, if this were really God's house, why would he not want his children to run and play? I would think that God would love, I would love to have his children run and play in his house. Unless, of course, the reason is that he doesn't want them to knock down his older children. Okay, that's a really good reason for your kids not to run in the building, right? That's the only reason right there. And my response to the other one, when somebody apologizes for swearing in front of the preacher, I always go, "It's okay, I know it's tough being an elder. I know it's really hard, so just let that go." That's weird, my note said pause for laughter right there. I guess you've been around the elders, right? So, all right. God's omnipresence makes every place a sacred place. It makes every moment a sacred moment. He is everywhere you are. So anywhere you go is a potential place of worship. You don't come to church in order to keep your appointment with God. Every second of every day is your appointed time. There's nothing, this space is no more sacred than the gym downstairs. And the gym downstairs is no more sacred than the fellowship hall or the kitchen or Whitesburg Drive or your house. God's everywhere. So every space and every moment is sacred. And then the last one, the last implication is this. If God is everywhere all the time, then no matter where you are and no matter what you're going through, he is there. He's fully present with you in that struggle. Isaiah 43. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. When you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. Do not be afraid. I am with you. That has powerful implications for us this morning. Deep, deep comfort. Let me ask you to do something with me. I'm going to ask you to affirm something with me. I'm going to offer some scenarios in which you might find yourself, others might find themselves. Just some situations and circumstances of distress. And at the end of each one of them, I want you to affirm with me, God is there
God is here. God is everywhere. Will you do that with me? Here we go. When you feel alone, God is there. God is here. God is everywhere. When your doctor gives you bad news, God is there. God is here. God is everywhere. When your child makes bad decisions, God is there. God is here. God is everywhere. When you feel like hurting yourself, God is there. God is here. God is everywhere. When your spouse says it's over, God is there. God is here. God is everywhere. When your parents were not there for you, God is there. God is here. God is everywhere. When you can't pay your bills, God is there. God is here. God is everywhere. When you're afraid about the future, God is there. God is here. God is everywhere. When you are tempted to do something you know is wrong, God is there. God is here. God is everywhere. And when you give in to that temptation, God is there. God is here. God is everywhere. No matter what, God is there. God is here. God is everywhere. You and I are not alone. Every moment of every day, our God is there. Our God is here. Our God is everywhere. Because He is God. We don't always do this, but I thought it would be a good idea to do it this morning. So what I'd like to do is give you the opportunity to tell us if you need us to pray about something. One of those scenarios or one that we didn't mention. We're going to start with a song, and I'd just like for you to listen. Let the first part of the song just sort of reflectively lead you into a place of deeper awareness of God's presence. And then as this song builds and grows, join in with us as we sing it. And if you need to come this morning, I'll be here. Some of our shepherds will come and pray with you, and we'll just be with you. God's already with you, but we'll be with you in a moment as well. So let's listen, and then we'll sing together.
He knows my
be seated, please. I have a couple of folks that came forward, and I'm going to ask Walton to come up, and Walton Harless to come up and lead us in a prayer for these. Okay, Lee's going to tell us about another one. Brian Coons has come forward, and he's experiencing a tremendous amount of anxiety these days, a lot of struggle going on in his heart, and it's just overwhelming to him. And so we're going to pray about that, and then Lee will tell us about the other one that's come forward. And then, Walton, will you do a prayer for both folks that came forward?
So Trey has come forward this morning, and he says that lately he just feels alone. Things aren't going great at work, in other aspects of his life, and he just reached out and says, you know, lonely is a hard place to be, and he asks for our thoughts and our friendship in that. Let's pray.
God, it is. We don't even need to invite you. You are, as we've talked about this morning, you are everywhere. And you are in our midst, all around us. You are lifting us up. But Father, we do ask that your strength is in the Spirit, the strength of your Spirit indwells in a powerful way. Trey and Brian this morning, they're crying out. I pray that you wrap your arms around Trey, drive away the loneliness, give him strength in the struggles. Father, I pray for Brian. As you know, he has a heart of gold. He has a heart for people, for his family. He has a tremendous amount of responsibilities in his work. A lot of pressures in his travel. And Father, I pray that you drive away his fears, help him to depend totally each moment, each minute, every hour, each day, in all the travels, in the work, in relationships with family, especially all of us, Father. We pray for our relationship with you. Make that real, Father. Today, right now, we know only in part. We only see in part, but Father, you one day promised us that we will know completely. But right now, Father, it is a walk of faith. One day we will see. But right now, Father, we pray for our faith. As the man said to Jesus, I believe and help, but help my unbelief. And Father, right now, that's what we cry out. Help our times of weakness, give us your strength. Help us our times of struggle, give us your victory. Father, help our times of loneliness, fill our hearts with an awareness of your presence. And all these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Walton, Lee, it's pretty intimidating to think about coming down in front of several hundred people and saying, hey, here's my thing, pray for me. So if you've got some stuff going on, you're not alone in it. The Lord is with you already, but we would be willing to be with you in that as well. And God sometimes uses people to help them to work through whatever's going on. So give us a call at the office. Shoot us an email. There's some information on the bulletin, the ways to get in contact with us, or go to the website, reach out to us that way. Don't struggle through this alone. There are people that will walk with you through that and would love the opportunity, be honored by the opportunity to do so, whatever it is. Wherever you go this week, realize the Lord got there ahead of you, and he is there before you get there. You are in his presence every step of the way. That's how we're going to close it out today. Before you leave, you give somebody a hug or a very firm handshake. Thanks for being here today.